Christ.
Jesus, our Savior.
Holy Spirit, our God is free and
35 through 38. Matthew 9, 35 through 38, and I've entitled the message this morning, "The Time is Now." The time is now. Again, Matthew's Gospel, chapter 9, beginning in verse number 35. You found your place, say amen.
Amen.
God's Word says, "Then Jesus went about all the cities and villages, teaching in their synagogues, preaching the gospel of the kingdom, and healing every sickness and every disease among the people. But when he saw the multitudes, he was moved with compassion for them, because they were weary and scattered, like sheep having no shepherd. Then he said to his disciples, 'The harvest truly is plentiful, but the laborers are few. Therefore pray the Lord of the harvest to send out laborers into his harvest.'" Let's pray together. Father, again, we thank you and we praise you for this opportunity to be in your house on this Lord's Day. Thank you, Lord, for the songs that have been sung. Lord, we pray that they uplifted your name. And Father, we pray right now that you would be with us as we hear from you, from your holy word. Father, I pray that you will just give us the supernatural ability to block out every distraction so that we can hear from heaven this morning. Father, we want you to come and we want you to move through the power of your Holy Spirit. We pray for you to convict hearts. Lord, we pray for salvation for those who are lost. And Lord, for us who've already been saved, Lord, I pray that you'll just give us the ability, Lord, to press on with your word. For us, in Jesus' name, I humbly pray. Amen. Up until my late 20s, I had the honor of working with my dad and uncle and grandfather on the farm. And for most of their career, for at least most of my life, their main crops that they planted were peanuts, cotton, and watermelons. Each year, my family would plant around 300 acres of watermelons, and we would begin to harvest those watermelons the first part of June, and we would harvest them through the second or third week of July. And the harvest of watermelons was somewhat different than harvesting peanuts and cotton. And what I mean by that is this: a watermelon is a perishable fruit. It is a perishable fruit. That simply means that a watermelon does not have a long shelf life. When harvest season begins, there is no days off. It is 7 days a week and a minimum of 12 to 16 hours a day. Why? Because when the watermelon becomes ripe, it is crucial that it is harvested right away. You only have so many days to get it out of the field, into the store, and onto someone's kitchen table. So why is there a quick harvesting process? Because you only have a short amount of time. You only have a short amount of time. And if you wait too long, the watermelon will spoil and it will rot before it reaches someone's table. So why is the harvest so crucial? Listen, church, it's because you only have a short period of time. You only have a small window of opportunity. For several services now, we have been looking at the crucial element of any church, and that is evangelism. We have looked at the great need for every member of this congregation to share the good news of Jesus. And today we will conclude our series on evangelism with the words from our Savior himself. Jesus has begun his earthly ministry. In Matthew chapter 7, he finishes preaching the Sermon on the Mount. And in Matthew chapter 8, we see that he comes down from that mountain and he begins his work. And in Matthew chapter 8, he cleanses the leper, he heals the centurion's servant, He heals Peter's mother-in-law. He teaches on discipleship. He rebukes the wind and the sea. And he casts out demons. In Matthew chapter 9, he continues his ministry. He heals the paralytic. He calls Matthew, the tax collector, that dreaded outcast, to be one of his disciples. He brings a little girl back to life. He heals the blind and he causes the mute to speak. You could say in just two chapters, Jesus had been very busy doing his Father's will. But what was the main purpose behind all of this? What was the main purpose for Jesus' healing, his teaching, and his calling of men to be his disciples? I believe it's for this purpose and this purpose alone. It's for people to believe that he was the Savior. It's for people to believe that he was the Savior of the world. Scripture clearly teaches in the gospel that Jesus came to do what? He came to seek and to save that which is lost. Again, his primary mission, to bring a lost world to himself. And we come to our text this morning, and we come to verse 35. And verse 35 tells us what? It tells us that Jesus is continuing to do what he's been doing over the last two chapters. He is going from city to city. He's going from village to village. And what is he doing? The text tells us he is teaching, he is preaching, and he is healing. He is teaching, preaching, and healing. Where is he teaching? Where is he preaching? Well, the text tells us he's going to the local synagogue. Why is he going to the local synagogues in these cities and villages? Because that is where the people are what? They are gathering corporately to worship. So what better place to go and to share the good news there where people are meeting? And what is his message? Well, he tells us that he is preaching. What does the word preaching mean? Preaching in its simplest form means that he is proclaiming, that he is delivering a proclamation. And what is this proclamation? Well, it tells us he's preaching the gospel. What does the word gospel mean? It literally means good news. And what is the good news? The good news is this. You're a sinner, but God will save you. God will save you. And how does God save you? We learned this last week as I preached our BBS theme verse found in Ephesians 2, 8 through 10. God saves people through the gift of his Son, through the gift of Jesus Christ. It's through the mercy and grace of him alone that we can be forgiven. So Jesus is preaching this gospel. Jesus is the Savior. Jesus was making a major evangelistic thrust for people to believe on him, and if they believed on him, they would have life everlasting. They would be forgiven of their sins. It says he came preaching the gospel of the kingdom. And there's a lot to unpack there, but I'm just going to simply say this. What is the kingdom of God? The kingdom of God is simply the rule and reign of God. It is the rule and reign of God. The one who is preaching here, who is Jesus, is what? He is God in the flesh. And because he is God in the flesh, he is sovereign over all. And what we see Jesus doing here is still one of the primary tasks of the church today. We are still called to teach and to preach to people the truth of God's Word. And by teaching truth, by teaching God's Word, by preaching God's Word, God will take his Word and supernaturally do what? Draw people to himself. I still love what H.B. Charles says. It's not my preaching that makes the Word of God work. It is the Word of God that makes preaching work. It is the Word that makes it work. And so that is what Jesus is doing. Again, we see him doing this as well. He's healing all kinds of diseases and infirmities. Again, his healing ministry was for one reason. What was his main reason for his healing ministry? For people to have a sign or a proof that he is the Messiah. And then we come to verse 36. And we have that very powerful conjuncting word, that conjunction there, and it's the word But. So Jesus was in the cities. He was in the villages preaching and healing. And there is something beautiful here that we sometimes just read right over. And that beautiful phrase is two words. He saw. But he saw. What did he see? Because when we look at this text, we may just see the miracles of healing that Jesus is doing. But these two words, he saw, let us know that Jesus sees something greater. A greater need than physical healing in individuals' lives. He sees something greater in this instant. And that greater need that he sees here is still the greater need in 2022. And this need surpasses a crippled leg. This need surpasses a deaf ears. This need surpasses physically blind eyes. And what Jesus saw, we as a church must see on this Lord's Day. And it's this. Jesus saw the vastness of lostness around him. Jesus saw the vastness of lostness around him. The text tells us here that when he saw the multitudes, he saw that they were dead in their sin, that they were spiritually blind. And when he saw this, he didn't do what the other religious leaders of his day were doing, ignoring the problem or shooing people away. The text tells us that when he saw the multitudes, the text says in verse 36, he was moved with compassion. He was moved with compassion. This means that he had a deep care for them. It means that he had a great love for them. It means that his heart went out to the people that he was ministering to. And his heart was so moved. Why? Because the people around him, he states, were what? They were weary and scattered. The word weary here means to be distressed. It conveys the idea of being battered, bruised, worn out. He saw how broken and inwardly devastating people's lives were. The Bible also says that he saw them, they looked like they were scattered. The word scattered can be translated downcast, or means that they were utterly helpless. We, as lost sheep, are utterly distressed and utterly helpless without a Savior, without a shepherd. So Jesus is saying, the lost need a what? The lost need a shepherd. And he is the only one who can be that shepherd for these people. Jesus will later state in John chapter 10, verse 11, I am the good shepherd. And the good shepherd will lay down his life for his sheep. A lost sheep is what? A lost sheep is battered. They are bruised. They are worn out. They are lost in their sin. And what does Isaiah the prophet in chapter 53 tell us that Jesus would do? That this shepherd would be led as a lamb. And what would happen to him? That he would be slaughtered and he would be bruised and he would be battered for our what? For our iniquity. For our sin. So when Jesus saw the multitude, he was moved with compassion because he saw the need for people to be saved from their sin. And when Jesus saw this, he didn't keep this to himself. In the preceding verse, it says that Jesus then turned to his disciples. And he said to them, the harvest is truly plentiful. The harvest is truly plentiful. Translation, Peter, James, and John, and all the rest, open up your eyes and look around. There is lostness all around. There are people who need the gospel. And there are people, according to Jesus, what does he say? The harvest is plentiful. That means to me that there is a vast majority of people who are lost, but there's also people who are ready to what? Respond to the gospel if they will just share it. How do we know this? Because Jesus states that the harvest is ready. When do we collect crops? We just learned that at what? At harvest time. We collect crops at harvest time. And he's saying, this crop is ready. It is ripe for the taking. He also says that this crop, that there is plenty. Church, I want you to know, you don't have to go far to find lost people. You don't have to travel across the globe. Praise God for our missionaries. Amen. We are to go to the uttermost. But you don't have to travel out of Worth County to find lost people. In fact, I believe this with my whole heart. We have lost people in our churches. We have lost people in our neighborhoods. We have lost people in our communities. And we have lost people in our families. We have lost people in our workplaces, and we have lost people in our schools. And we would realize that if we would just open up our eyes and see the way Jesus sees people. Instead of looking at people and looking at sinners with eyes of condemnation, we as God's people need to start looking at them with eyes of compassion, because when we start looking at people the way Jesus looks at people, we will begin to see that these people truly need the Lord. They truly need the Lord. Jesus also revealed this truth to his disciples when he encountered the Samaritan woman at the well, and he led her to himself. She got saved, and when she was running off, going into her village to tell others, his disciples come up and they're basically like, why are you talking to her? She's a Samaritan. And in John 4, verse 35, Jesus looks at his disciples there and basically says the same thing. He points to Samaria and he says, guys, lift up your eyes and look. For the fields are white unto the harvest. Disciples, what your problem is, you're looking at them like Samaritans. You've given them a label. You think they're the scum, the trash, the society. But you need to see that the Samaritans are a people who need a Savior. And the text tells us that Jesus and the disciples stay there in that village, and what happened? Many in that village came to what? A saving faith in Jesus Christ. So the harvest is plentiful. Amen? There's a great harvest right here in Worth County that can be had. But Jesus also reveals the problem. Yes, there's an abundance, there's plenty to be harvested, but there are only a few. There's only a few who are willing to do the work. A few. I can make you this promise. If there was only a few in Jesus' day willing to do his work, there's still a few in his church today that are only willing to do his work. One of the critical needs for ministry in the church today is for workers to go into the field. It's for the people of God to be missionaries where God has planted them. It is crucial we who have been redeemed share the gospel. It's just not my responsibility to share it. It's equally your responsibility to share your faith with others. And it's crucial. Even if we only have a remnant that are doing it, we do the work of the Lord. We work the fields. We share hope with a lost and dying world. For there's something else we as a redeemed can do. We can also pray. Jesus says the harvest is plentiful, the laborers are few. Therefore, pray. Pray for what? That the Lord of the harvest will send others who will join him in sharing the good news of whose harvest is it anyway? It's his harvest. Are we to pray for the lost, Pastor? Absolutely. We are to lift up our lost friends and family to the Lord. But Jesus says here in this context that we are to pray more specifically for people to take witnessing seriously. To take witnessing seriously. Pray for people to see Jesus for who he is, and for us to see people the way Jesus sees people, and for us to pray for people to have a great concern and compassion for the lost, and for them to care enough to share the news that can change their eternal destiny. At the beginning of this message, I shared, when harvest time for a watermelon comes around, you have to get it right in. Why? Because if you wait, that watermelon will spoil, it will rot, and it will die. I entitled this message, "The Time Is Now." Why is the time now? You don't have to look far, and you can see people are in despair. And people are dying every day with no hope. And if you and I have the cure to cure this world's disease of sin, we have the medicine, we have the antidote, if we'll just begin to share for those around us and watch God work. And I know it's not popular in many circles. And it's not even popular in some churches. But God's word has not changed, church. God is immutable. He is the same yesterday, today, and forevermore. And if God doesn't change, his word doesn't change. And if we don't share the gospel, and we don't give people an opportunity to respond to the gospel, when they die, they're not going to heaven. They're going to hell. They're going to hell. Pastor, you mean people don't hear the gospel? If they die, they're going to hell because they're sinners who need Jesus. That's why we don't have time to wait. Because I guarantee you, out of the thousands and thousands and thousands that die around the world every single day, most of them are lost. Most of them aren't saved. 8 out of 10 people right here in our own county are lost and going to hell. 8 out of 10. There's work to be done. There's work to be done. Just getting off our blessed assurance, getting out of that comfortable pew, and start having gospel conversations with people that God puts us in front of. Eva Hart remembered the night very well. It was April the 15th, 1912. It was the night that the Titanic plunged 12,000 feet to the Atlantic floor. Some 2 hours and 40 minutes after this massive ship hit an iceberg, and that iceberg tore a 300-foot gash into the side of the ship. And she said this, "I saw all the horror of that ship sinking, but what I heard was far worse, even more dreadful. It was the cries of people who were drowning." The cries of people who were drowning. Even though there was 20 lifeboats and rafts that were launched, too few and only partly filled, most of the passengers ended up struggling in the icy seas while those boats waited a safe distance away from the people. Listen, church. Those already saved in the boats, only half filled, floated aimlessly in the night while hearing others perish. Our Savior said again, I came to seek and to save that which is lost. And that commission that we have seen over and over for several weeks now is given to us. But too many of us sit safely in our pews while those around us are perishing. And friend, I'm going to promise you this again. If we don't go, they will perish for all eternity. They will perish. So may we never sit in our pews safely while others are perishing in the waters around us. The time is now. Today is the day that you need to start sharing the good news of Jesus with the lost and dying world around you. Just this past week as I was studying, I checked my email and I subscribed to several different pastors and church leaders' emails, and one of the ones I get is from Tom Rainer. And God just used Tom Rainer to confirm the great need for the church to get back to evangelism. And in his email this week, his little blog, his blog was entitled, Church Without Evangelism. A church without evangelism. And listen to the repercussions of a church where its members do not take evangelism seriously and share it where God has planted them. A church without evangelism becomes a church that does not make disciples because there are no new Christians to disciple. A church without evangelism becomes a church where members fight over their preferences because the members do not focus on reaching those who are not followers of Jesus. A church without evangelism becomes a church without true fellowship, which is our next pillar that we're going to be looking at in our sermon series. Because true fellowship not only cares for its own, but it looks beyond its own. A church without evangelism gets mad at the pastor because the members think they pay the pastor to do the evangelism for them. A church without evangelism becomes a church that does not do ministry because there are fewer and fewer members to do the ministry. A church without evangelism becomes a church that strays from the Bible, because the Bible clearly teaches to evangelize people with the gospel. A church without evangelism becomes a church giving less to missions because there are fewer people to give to missions. A church without evangelism becomes a church without prayer, because churches that truly pray are concerned for the lost in their communities. A church without evangelism becomes a church that cannot worship together because there are fewer people to attend those worship services. A church without evangelism will soon close its doors, and he states that's probably best. That's probably blessed if they're not, it's best if they're not doing what God has told them to do. Because the church stopped being the church a long time ago when it decided to no longer to be obedient to the great commission of Jesus Christ. Church, the time is now. Let's get busy doing what we know to be doing. Keep the main thing, and watch God work in and through your life in great and mighty ways. Let's pray. Father, thank you for this time. Thank you for always leading us to your word. Thank you for this sermon series that we have been looking at for several weeks now, Lord, on the topic of evangelism. And Lord, I pray that each and every one of us in here will see the desperate need around us, Lord, and that we will quit putting off what we know that we need to be doing, and that's sharing the love of God through Christ Jesus, Lord. May we truly see, God, that you can give us the ability to share our faith with those around us. You give us that power through the presence of your Holy Spirit. Father, if there's anyone here today that needs Jesus, I pray that they know that he died for them, he rose again for them, and as Scripture teaches, if they'll just confess him as Lord and believe on him, they can be saved from their sins. Lord, I pray for this altar to be flooded with people who are just serious about sharing Jesus with this community. Of course, in Christ's name I pray. Amen.